Hi, thank you all for coming. So thank you guys for being here and welcome to the thousands of people watching on YAF's YouTube and Facebook page. My name is Zachary Miller. I'm chairman of Baylor Young Americans for Freedom. It's been a long road to get here, but we're thrilled to have Ben Shapiro here with us tonight. Ben is the editor-in-chief of the Daily Wire, host of the Ben Shapiro Show, and a New York Times number one best-selling author. I'd like to thank Young America's Foundation, Fred Allen, our chapter's individual donors, and the Baylor student government, without whom this event would not be possible. Now, if you please direct your attention to the video screens, we have a special message from a friend of Baylor YAF.
Good evening. I want to thank all of you for coming to this special event. I wish I could be with you in person, and I know that YAF will make sure y'all will have a wonderful time tonight. I'd like to take a moment to introduce a tireless fighter for conservative values and limited government. He's come all the way from the People's Republic of California to join us here tonight in the great state of Texas. Please join me in giving my good friend, Ben Shapiro, a warm Baylor Bears welcome. Ben, welcome to Wake.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ben Shapiro!
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, I can certainly see why my business partner keeps recommending we move to Texas. Well, first of all, thanks to YAF, thanks to Fred R. Allen for sponsoring this series. Thanks, of course, to the administration at Baylor University for ensuring that we can have a wonderful, peaceful event. And thanks to law enforcement for ensuring that we can do the same. I also want to thank anybody in the audience who may be inclined to disagree from the outset. I mean, there may be some brave people here who are on the left, people who are liberal, and really, we should give them a big round of applause for being willing to open up their mind and come out tonight. Alrighty, so tonight I'm talking about why the left hates science. And now, to a lot of folks on the left, this sounds ridiculous. After all, it's right-wingers who are climate deniers and science deniers, and they believe in that book, The Bible, and they're all wild and crazy. They don't believe in anything like the scientific method. But the truth is that right now, many of the attacks on science are coming from the political left. The leftists like science right now because the left tends to believe in infinite human malleability, which provides the impetus for top-down government control. Because if people can change from anything to anything, if people can be anything that government makes them, then government can fix the entire world simply by changing human beings. If you remove the mediating institutions of society, human beings can be remade from the top down. Infinite engineering of humankind, unfortunately, tends to be undermined by the facts of human nature. Conservatives tend to believe that there is such a thing as a fixed human nature. Now, that does not mean that all human beings operate in exactly the same way, because of course we don't. But it does mean that human beings are happiest when they exercise reason in accordance with that nature. So yeah, of course we have the capacity to change, but that capacity to change is going to be limited by human nature. It's not infinite. You can't just change the economic system and people stop being people and then turn into new, wonderful people. There's this bizarre notion that has been pressed by people like Elizabeth Warren, that as soon as you become a billionaire, you become evil, for example. And this is weird, because obviously people are people, whether they are rich or whether they are poor. But according to the left, if you got rid of billionaires, then everybody would be wonderful, as though everyone who is not billionaire is wonderful and everybody who's a billionaire is a jerk. That, of course, is not true. I know billionaires who are jerks. I know billionaires who are wonderful. I know poor people who are jerks and poor people who are wonderful. Human beings are good, human beings are bad, and we're everything in between. Now, the left likes to pretend that it loves science, but much of what it terms science is not, in fact, science. So, for example, I was a political science major at UCLA. For all of those who are political science majors, you are not learning actual science. You are mainly learning people's opinions and some bad sociology. The social sciences often do not meet the rigorous standards of science. But here's what the left really means. When they say that people on the right are science deniers, what they really mean is that science is anything that is not religion, right? All of world knowledge separates into two categories, religion and science. And so if it's not religion, it must be science. That's because people on the secular left tend to see religion as an obstacle to progress, like all progress. And they're not just merely concerned with Galileo, who, by the way, was an ardent believer in the divine. They're concerned that religion acts as a sort of retrograde check on their ambitions to rewrite society, including the rewriting of fundamental societal truths like distinctions between the sexes and the value of family unit. Animus for religion is why many people on the left will routinely characterize science-based conservative positions as religious in nature. So, for example, if you say you're pro-life, very often you'll hear from people on the secular left that you're only pro-life because you're religious. Now, the vast majority of people who are pro-life, I know them a lot better than people on the secular left do. They never cite the Bible in explaining why they are pro-life. They cite science in explaining why they are pro-life. It's a straw man to suggest that people who are pro-life in defiance of science. They are pro-life because of science. This hard distinction that the left likes to draw between religion, which is not science, on the one hand, and science on the other, is a false binary. The distinction rests on an utter misunderstanding of both science and religion. Of course, it is an unscientific claim to claim that, as I believe, God spoke directly to mankind at Mount Sinai, or as Christians believe that Jesus rose from the dead, or that Muhammad ascended to heaven, as Muslims believe. None of that is scientific. These claims are obviously miraculous and therefore unprovable. But science does rest on fundamental assumptions drawn from Judeo-Christian values and religious premises. By the way, these are present in original Islamic thought as well. This is why for 1,000 years, the chief proponents of science were sponsored by the Catholic Church, for example. If Aristotle is considered the father of science, Thomas Aquinas repopularized Aristotle in the Christian world, Maimonides in the Jewish world, Al-Farabi in the Islamic world. Newton saw his work as an extension of his religious worldview. Johannes Kepler, discoverer of the laws of planetary motion, stated, quote, "The chief aim of all investigations of the external world should be to discover the rational order and harmony imposed on it by God and which he revealed to us in the language of mathematics." Isaac Newton felt the same way. He said, "Opposite to God is atheism in profession and idolatry in practice. Atheism is so senseless and odious to mankind that it never had many professors." Francis Bacon, who's considered the modern father of empiricism, wrote this prayer at the beginning of his Novum Organum. He said, "Let mankind regain their rights over nature assigned to them by the gift of God and obtain that power whose exercise will be governed by right reason and true religion." So, what exactly are the fundamental principles of science that can't actually be proved by science? Well, first, that the universe is an orderly place with discoverable rules. And that's an assumption you have to make about the universe. That exists from a religious premise, but it doesn't exist from a scientific premise specifically. It could be a very chaotic place with no governable rules. That first assumption is indeed an assumption. And then there's a second assumption, that the human mind is capable of actually understanding something like absolute truth. If you're a believer in evolutionary biology, there's nothing in evolutionary biology that suggests that your perception of the universe is anything other than an effective adaptation. Right? You're effectively adapting to the world around you, but that does not suggest there's anything like an absolute truth. So believing in absolute truth is a faith principle. Okay, those principles do not exist inside science itself. Furthermore, it is worth noting that religion granted science its guardrails. Science moored to basic moral principle, historically drawn in the West from Judeo-Christian worldview, betters our world. Pseudoscience designed to shape morality leads to disastrous ends. This is why eugenic race science was enthusiastically embraced by the secular left across Europe and the United States. As soon as you unmoor science from morality, science goes in pretty ugly places. So now let's talk about science today. As I've said a couple of times, the left routinely declares people on the right science deniers. They'll talk about how some on the right deny the reality of climate change or call it a hoax. Fair enough. As you'll hear tonight, I have no doubt that climate change is happening. Even people who are so-called climate change deniers, lukewarmers as they're called very often, acknowledge that climate change is happening. I'll also acknowledge that human activity is responsible for a percentage of that change. Even the people who are sort of lukewarm, people like Roy Spencer, who you've heard on Rush Limbaugh Show, right, he will say that half or more of all climate change in terms of global warming is probably caused by human activity. But as you'll also hear, it is the left that refuses to acknowledge that the solutions it routinely suggests are utterly unworkable and ridiculous and do not accomplish anything like what they say they will accomplish. You'll also hear from the left that some people on the right deny Darwinian evolution. Now, listen, I'm a believer in macroevolution, although it is certainly difficult to reconcile the fossil record with the idea of a steady and gradualistic evolution of species based alone on natural selection and random mutation. But the notion that natural processes led to evolution of species seems perfectly consonant with both religious teleology and scientific investigation. The broader problem for science is not on individual issues, which, believe me, we'll get to some individual issues in just a second. It's the left's willingness to deny the methodologies of science themselves. Most prominently, the left has determined that certain areas of science are simply unworthy of investigation, that investigation of those areas conflicts with deeply held moral beliefs, which, for the record, should show you that when the left says that its morality is based on science, that's obviously a lie. If they believe that their morality was based on science, then science should be able to investigate whatever it wants, and they wouldn't have to put limits on what science can investigate. So, what do I mean? Well, on the left, science must be curbed in order to uphold the completely false idea of a tabula rasa human nature, of a completely blank slate human nature. Harvard psychology professor Steven Pinker has written, "The dogma that human nature does not exist in the face of growing evidence from science and common sense that it does has led to contempt among many scholars in the humanities for the concepts of evidence and truth. Worse, the doctrine of the blank slate often distorts science itself by making an extreme position that culture alone determines behavior seem moderate, and by making the moderate position that behavior comes from an interaction of biology and culture seem extreme." So here's an example. Last year, Brown University assistant professor of the practice of behavioral and social sciences at the School of Health, her name is Lisa Littman, released a study. The study focused on what it described as rapid onset gender dysphoria that was not present in early youth, but that manifested within days or weeks in teens and young adults. According to Science Daily, Littman's study found that, quote, 21% of parents reported their child had one or more friends who had become transgender identified at around the same time. 20% reported an increase in their child's social media use around the same time as experiencing gender dysphoria symptoms, and 45% reported both. The pattern of clusters of teens in friend groups becoming transgender identified, the group dynamics of these friend groups, and the type of advice viewed online led her to the hypothesis that friends and online sources could spread certain beliefs. Littman explained, of the parents who provided information about their child's friendship group, about a third responded that more than half of the kids in the friendship group became transgender identified, which obviously does not suggest a biological cause. It suggests at least an environmental cause, right? Groups of kids are deciding together very often that they are transgender. A group with 50% of its members becoming transgender identified represents a rate that is more than 70 times the expected prevalence for young adults. So this study obviously crossed a bunch of taboo political lines. So what did Brown University do? They got a bunch of flack. They immediately pulled down the press release about it. Brown School of Public Health Dean Bess Marcus issued a letter to the entire community. The letter explained, "The spirit of free inquiry and scholarly debate is central to academic excellence. At the same time," and you know where this is going, right? "At the same time, we believe firmly it is also incumbent on public health researchers to listen to multiple perspectives and to recognize and articulate the limitations of their work." In other words, the science had to come secondarily to the politics. She made a boo-boo, this professor. She came up with results that did not meet with the prevailing social trends that the left wished to instill. We've seen this happen repeatedly. We've seen this happen to Sam Harris, who's an atheist, who's on the left, who pointed out that IQ differentials between groups do exist. He didn't say that they were purely genetic. He said they were a combination of probably genetics and environment. He didn't know to what percentage that was true. But he got blasted anyway. Ezra Klein of Vox complained, "These hypotheses about biological racial difference are now and have always been used to advance clear political agendas." Well, so what? Does that mean that the science itself is invalid? Is the idea you're not allowed to ask a specific scientific question because it may be used for a bad political use? That's true for virtually all science. The nuclear bomb can be used for deterrence or it can be used for aggressive use. Does that mean that we should not ever express a desire to learn about the science of nuclear energy? We saw this with former Harvard President Lawrence Summers, again, a Democrat, served in the Clinton administration as Treasury Secretary. He found himself out on his ass at my former school after he made a speech pointing out that disparities between men and women in hard sciences were due in part to the fact that women populate the middle of the bell curve on math and science tests, while men populate the extremes. Men are either the best at math or they are the worst at math, and there is not much in between. By the way, men are like this about everything. Right? We're the best, we are the best at something or we are the worst at something. Right? There is nothing in between. Jordan Peterson was warned by the University of Toronto not to use biological pronouns. Professor Scott Yenner of Boise State was disciplined by his university after he suggested that radical feminism's ridiculous notion that gender is purely a social construct had actually prefaced the transgender right movement's same argument. Heather Heyer, again, a socialist as far as I'm aware, right, she's a professor at Evergreen State College, or at least she was met with walkouts when she pointed out the fact that men are on average taller than women. I'm right at the average, guys. But let me just tell you, it's true. Meanwhile, science has been placed in the service of idiotic notions like implicit bias, which is a deeply unsubstantiated pseudoscientific theory because it's nearly impossible to measure. The implicit bias assessment test that you've heard in your sociology class, it's been debunked repeatedly. It doesn't have any real world, even the people who designed it acknowledge that it has no real world correlation with quote unquote racist behavior. Also, you can game the test. You can take it once, then you can take it a second time and come up with a completely different result, which is a good example of how a test does not work. The National Science Foundation has spent millions of dollars on this nonsense, and they dumped $500,000 into studying intersectionality too. Scientific standards for organizational staffing are changing. The American Astronomical Society recently suggested that PhD programs stop using the GRE in physics for applicants because not enough women were doing well. Medical schools are being encouraged to drop the MCAT because ethnic minorities have apparently been underperforming on average. And so you end up with the idiotic spectacle of Rachel Maddow of MSNBC. She walked into, a few years ago, NPR told this story, it's an amazing story. She walked into Rockefeller University and she saw a wall, and the wall was covered with pictures of white men. And she said, what's up with the dude wall? Well, it turns out that the dude wall were all the people who have won either a Nobel Prize or a Lasker Award. Right? There was people who had won scientific or math prizes. But the only thing that she saw was a dude wall, not a group of individuals who had made discoveries, a dude wall. So what did Rockefeller University do? They tried to change the constituency of the dude wall. Okay, listen, one of the great tragedies of Western civilization and of society in general is that minorities and women have not been given enough opportunities historically in these areas. But that does not demean the accomplishments of the people who actually were given the opportunity and did well in the areas. It's insane to pull down the picture of a Nobel Prize winner because you have to replace them with a woman who is not a Nobel Prize winner. That's silliness. Okay, all of this is because science might not agree with the prevailing norms of leftist politics. In fact, there are some fringe characters on the left who are increasingly becoming mainstream who have suggested that the scientific method itself is discriminatory. So, for example, Donna Hughes in the Women's Studies International Forum, which makes for exciting bedtime reading, stated, quote, the scientific method is a tool for the construction and justification of dominance in the world. If you can unpack that sentence, you're dumber than I am, sorry. Computational biologist Laura Boykin recently told Wired magazine, as in this week, quote, science at its core is systematically racist and sexist. Now, if you're trying to prove that women are just as good at science as men are, then as a woman, you should not say things like, science at its core is systematically racist and sexist, because this proves that you do not understand either science or math. Okay, now let's move on to some specific issues in science, issues on which the left specifically and completely denies the science. Let's focus on three: abortion, transgenderism, and climate change. So this is the good stuff. First, on abortion. The left insists that it has a scientific perspective on abortion, which is bizarre, because their perspective is that a woman gets to decide randomly when a human life constitutes a human life. Literally at any point. She can decide one day it's a human life, she can decide the next day it's not a human life. This is nonsensical. It's non-objective. There is no standard by which anyone can be held to account. This is utterly, utterly unscientific. Okay, when does it begin, human life? Well, the obvious answer is it begins at conception. By every biological criteria, a new human life begins at conception. But the left insists that human life can be subjectively defined by a woman pregnant with a child. So again, at any point, a woman can decide that an independent human life is in fact an independent human life, which, it is worthy of note, is exactly the same argument that has been made in the past to dehumanize entire groups of people. Right? This was an argument made by the Nazis about Jews, that they were not human and therefore they could be treated as non-humans. It was an argument that was made by white slaveholders when they said that black people were not fully human and therefore could be treated as property. To demean an entire class of human beings because they exist in the womb and not outside of the womb, to pretend that a human life is not a human life, is an asinine, unscientific position. Now, if you want to make the argument, which the left will not, if you want to make the argument that yes, it's a human life, but other priorities should trump, that's at least an argument that has some logical credence to it. I would say it has no moral credence, but it's at least got some logical consistency to it. But if you want to make the argument that a human life begins when a woman says so, that's absurd. I mean, I have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old right now. There are times when they are acting absolutely inhuman. But I promise you, they're human beings. Which is why the most honest abortion advocates will simply say an unborn child is an unborn child, and that an unborn child's interest in life doesn't outweigh the mother's preference. But most abortion advocates won't be so honest because that's a really ugly thing to say. Instead, they participate in the blatantly anti-scientific lie that an embryo or a fetus is not a human life, and they attempt to draw the line at feeling pain or brain function or viability or any other variety of irrelevant points that would not apply to somebody who are an adult. They're human beings who are fully grown, who cannot feel pain. They are human lives. People who are paralyzed from the waist down cannot feel pain in their legs. Does this mean that they are no longer human lives? If they were quadriplegic, would that mean that they were no longer human lives? Brain function. Okay, when you go to sleep every night, your brain function drops fairly dramatically. Does this mean you are no longer a human life while you are asleep? Viability. You can exist on your own. Okay, I promise you, if I leave my 3-year-old alone for more than 7 minutes at a time, he will be dead. The process of human life begins at conception. A new creature is created with its own genetics, its own blood type, its own body. Human life changes over time, and brain development changes over time, but that does not mean that a child is less human than an adult, or that a person with Down syndrome is less human than a person without that condition. And if you need citations to authority because you don't believe me or basic logic or basic human biology, Professor Jaime Gordon of the Mayo Clinic says, quote, by all the criteria of modern molecular biology, life is present from the moment of conception. Professor Micheline Matthews-Roth of Harvard Medical School says it is incorrect to say that biological data cannot be decisive. It is scientifically correct to say that an individual life begins at conception. Now, again, all the other standards do not hold. Now, let's go to another one. Let's do transgenderism, right? Because this is the hot topic, right? If I say that a man is a man and a woman is a woman, this is obviously deeply controversial because the entire society has fallen down and hit its head. There are these categories. I know, this is basic stuff. There are these categories. They're called male and female. They exist in all mammalian species. There is a small category of people who are intersex, meaning that they have the sex organs of both male and female, or have a condition where their hormonal development does not match their chromosomal genetics. This is a very tiny percentage of the population. That is not what transgender advocates mean when they say that a trans male is a male. Okay, if they're just talking about intersex people, they'd at least have an argument. If they're talking about Caitlyn Jenner is a woman in the same way that my wife is a woman, this is obviously untrue, and it's very silly to boot. Trans men are not men, they are women. Trans women are not women, they are men. This is because words have definitions. Now listen, this is not meant to be mean. If I'm in a room with somebody having dinner with them and they happen to be transgender, I'll call them by any pronoun they want because I don't want to be rude, because I'm trying to be polite. But as a society, if we are going to dictate that men and women are interchangeable terms and that a man can be a woman and a woman can be a man, then we have gone off the deep end. No transgender advocate, no transgender rights advocate can come up with a workable definition of man or woman. There is no workable definition if you believe these terms are entirely interchangeable. Right? If you define men and women biologically, the categories are distinct and rigid, and they can't be changed by a surgery. If you define men and women by gender stereotyping, which is what the transgender rights movement now says, right? They say that gender is completely disconnected from sex, and that gender is just a group of stereotypes that are masculine or feminine in attribute, then you have to explain why the gender stereotypes exist in the first place. Were they originally connected to biology? In which case, your gender case has collapsed back into the sex case, right? That there's male and female. Or were they based in social construct? In which case, the characteristics you consider male are not actually male at all. So a trans man is not a man, a trans man is a person, and all of us are just people, and there's no such thing as a man or a woman in the first place. So either the categories exist or they don't exist, but you can't have it both ways, right? You can't have it where men and women don't exist biologically, but they do exist in terms of gender, but they also don't exist if you decide to change gender, right? That doesn't work. If sex exists, transgenderism cannot cross these lines. If gender exists, it is binary and therefore non-fluid. Nonetheless, we now see the idiotic spectacle of people using the phrase sex assigned at birth. This is ridiculous. Sex is not assigned at birth any more than the number of fingers you have. It is like saying you were assigned 10 fingers at birth. You were not. We recognized an underlying truth. You had 10 fingers when you were born. It is biologically ingrained, end of story. But some academics disagree because apparently the more years you spend on a college campus, the dumber you get. Dr. Deanna Adkins, Dr. Deanna Adkins of Duke University School of Medicine claims that gender identity is the only medically supported determinant of sex. The only medically supported determinant of sex. You getting this? Gender identity, how you subjectively identify, is the only medically supported determinant of sex. She then explains it is counter to medical science to use chromosomes, hormones, internal reproductive organs, external genitalia, or secondary sex characteristics to override gender identity for purposes of classifying someone as male or female. Apparently, you do not have to know what the words medicine or science are to be a science and medicine professor at Duke. As Ryan Anderson of the Heritage Foundation points out, Adkins doesn't say if she would apply this rule to all mammalian species. So how would you classify a female deer or a male deer? How would you do this? Would you ask them their identity? How would it work with an armadillo exactly? Why should sex be determined differently in humans than in other mammals? And if medical science holds that gender identity determines sex in humans, says Ryan, what does this mean for the use of medicinal agents that have different effects on males and females? Does the proper dosage of medicine depend on the patient's sex or gender identity? Unfortunately, what we are seeing is that this ridiculous and anti-scientific viewpoint is winning out in the world of the left. We actually see doctors being forced by hospitals to write on forms that a man is having a period, which makes it actually rather difficult for doctors to diagnose patients correctly. Since, as it turns out, men and women are built differently. Spoiler alert for those of you in the room, not the same. So this ends up with horrible cases like this one. Earlier this year, the New England Journal of Medicine reported that a woman gave birth to a stillborn baby. Actually, let me be more exact. The New England Journal of Medicine reported earlier this year that a man gave birth to a stillborn baby. Why was the baby stillborn? Because this was a biological woman who identified as a man. And so the medical staff listed her as a male. This meant that she was misdiagnosed. Nobody knew she was a pregnant woman because she identified as an obese male. So the baby died. The New England Journal of Medicine therefore recommended that nurses stop being sexist in their examinations. So presumably, women should now be subjected to prostate exams and men should be given pap smears. Then there's the commonplace take on trans women in bathrooms or in sports. So it's now sexist. If you're a girl and you want to be in a locker room with other girls because you're on the swim team and you want to get undressed and you find it uncomfortable when a boy with all of the appendages walks in out of the shower and takes a look at you, this is because you are mean and bigoted. You're also mean and bigoted if you happen to be a female bikini waxer who prefers not to wax balls. I'm not kidding. This is an actual case that just happened in Canada. Recently, there was a case in Canada. It went up to the highest court, considering whether a cosmetologist could be forced to wax a man's junk so long as he identified as a woman. Okay, for some odd reason, I honestly don't know how the British Columbia Court of Human Rights, the Human Rights Council, I do not understand how they ruled against the transgender person given all of their pre-stated suppositions. It didn't make any sense. Meanwhile, the ACLU actually celebrated International Men's Day this week by saying, quote, men who get their periods are men. Oh. These are the same geniuses who suggest that men should be able to compete against women so long as they identify as women. Because, quote, this is what the ACLU said. Remember that time when the ACLU was just about protecting free speech and not about utter and complete inability to control their prefrontal cortex? Well, now they have tweeted out, okay, they tweeted out, this is a statement, right? Transgender girls are often told that they are not girls. And conversely, transgender boys are told they are not really boys based on inaccurate stereotypes about biology, athleticism, and gender. So boys should be able to play against girls because it's an inaccurate stereotype that men are generally better at most athletic pursuits than women. Okay, that's not called inaccurate stereotyping. I'm sorry, that's called fact. Men have completely different musculature than women. Men have greater bone density than women. If this were not true, you would have seen Lisa Leslie dominating the NBA, not the WNBA. The WNBA wouldn't need to be subsidized by the NBA if this were true. LeBron James would be getting posterized by Sue Bird. Sexual differences are reflected in sports performance, of course, which is why you have different classifications for male and female sports in every area of human life. David Epstein writes in The Sports Gene, you know, there's this whole thing going around that there's no such thing as throws like a girl. There is such a thing as throws like a girl. Hey, Barack Obama throws like a girl. He's got a better basketball game than I do, but the man throws like a girl. I mean, he threw at the All-Star game, and they actually had to cut a different camera angle so that it didn't appear that he threw like a girl. But that's beside the point. What I mean by throwing like a girl is this specific fact. According to David Epstein, if you pulled 1,000 men off the street, 1,000 of them, 997 of them would be able to throw a ball harder than the average woman would. Okay, now that does not mean that a woman at the upper end of the spectrum can't throw a ball pretty hard. She can. I believe that the fastest woman has been clocked is around 80 miles an hour, which would not make you into single-A baseball, right? That is not a rip on women in a wide variety of other ways. Women are much better at many other things. Women are very often more reasonable and smarter. Ask my wife. But in a let's throw the baseball competition, if you didn't know anything except I'm a man and my wife's a woman, you should pick me to throw a baseball. Okay, this is why any reasonable person understands that having a man who identifies as a woman fight in MMA is a dangerous thing to do. That if you have a man who has developed throughout his entire teenage years as a man, and only now at age 23 is he taking estrogen, and his bone density has already been developed, and his musculature has already been developed, if he hits a woman, it is a dangerous thing. When Fallon Fox wanted to participate in MMA, that was dangerous. Women who participate in MMA against Fallon Fox said, I've never been hit like that before. Right, because men weren't hitting you before. The most extreme example of the idiocy of all of this is that apparently it is now sexist for you to be attracted to members of either the same sex or the opposite sex. Right, if you discriminate in your sexual life between members of the opposite sex and member of the same sex, this is because you are a sexist. There have been a bevy of articles recently at places like Huffington Post, repository for all stupidity on the internet, suggesting, I have some bad news, dudes. Dudes, it turns out, according to the Huffington Post and a bevy of wild left sites, that if you don't want to have sex with a transgender woman, i.e. a woman with a twig and berries, that is actually because you hate women and don't understand them. So if you don't want to have sex with a man identifying as a woman, it's because you're gay. I got nothing. Nothing. Now look, gender identity disorder, gender dysphoria, it is indeed, it's a disorder. It's a difficult, horrible disorder. We should treat everyone who has this disorder with an enormous amount of sympathy. If you've ever had anyone in your family who has suffered from a mental disorder, it is horrific, it is difficult, they deserve sympathy, they deserve your help, right? I mean, all of this can be true. None of this means that society at large is supposed to start justifying the idea that men are women and women are men. That's absolutely silly. Okay, a man who says he is a woman is not, in fact, a woman. He is a man with a disorder. The transition from the term even gender identity disorder to gender dysphoria was entirely political and unsupportable by the evidence. The World Professional Association for Transgender Health celebrated the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual's decision to reclassify the order as gender dysphoria. Why? Not on the basis of science, but because the term is, quote, less pathologizing, as it no longer implies that one's identity is disordered. Well, if the choice is your identity is disordered or your body is disordered, of course your identity is disordered. There is nothing wrong with your physical body, right? There is something wrong with your mental function, obviously. It is a mental disorder. Any attempt to classify this as anything other than a disorder is asinine. It's similar to saying somebody is anorexic and has body dysmorphia, right? Somebody has a body identity disorder. And then we say to them, no, actually, you're right. Even though you are 50 pounds underweight and in danger of death, actually you are fat. You are correct, right? You are actually overweight. And that's not a disorder, that's a dysphoria, right? You are not doing the person any favors. Now listen, I'm not even making any recommendations as to the proper treatment here. Apparently, there are not any wonderful treatments that are available for gender identity disorder, right? And if you're an adult and you wish to get surgeries that make you feel better about yourself, as a libertarian, I feel that should be legal. I think it should be outlawed for people who are under the age of 18 and incapable of consent. I don't think parents should be shooting up their 12-year-olds with hormones designed to make sexual decisions about their lives before they're even capable of understanding what that means. But to suggest again that the transgender right movement insistence that a man is a woman and a woman is a man, that's just very silly. Okay, now to climate change. So, few stipulations. One, the world is warming. This is not, in fact, a Chinese hoax. Okay, it's a thing that's happening. There are four serious questions to be asked about climate change. One, how much is the world warming? Two, how much of this is caused by humanity? Three, how much warming is actually dangerous? And four, what do we do about it? Now, what the left does is they give a vague answer to number one. So they'll say just a lot, right? They'll say, how much is it warming? They say a lot. And they say, how much is human caused? All of it. And how much of it is dangerous? Any of it. And fourth, what do we do about it? We destroy the entire world economy. Right, this is... this is the perspective of AOC's idiotic Green New Deal, which she acknowledges fully was really an attempt to redefine the entire nature of economics with regard to humankind. It really was not about just global warming per se. Okay, so first, how much global warming is happening? According to the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which, again, I have no reason to seriously doubt their conclusions, they suggest the climate is likely to warm somewhere between 1.5 degrees Celsius and 4 degrees Celsius by the end of the century, which is a rather broad range, you may notice, between 1.5 degrees Celsius and 4 degrees Celsius. We don't know if we're going to end up in the middle, at the bottom, near the top. We also don't know where the tipping points are, right? Where there is, where a little bit more climate change means that there's serious coral reef die-off, or serious ocean acidification, or serious polar cap ice melting. And so what you'll see very often in the media is this worst-case scenario kind of reporting. So they'll say, well, you know, if by the end of the centuries all the polar ice caps melted, then New York would be underwater. Right, and if an asteroid hits Earth, we're all dead. Okay, the fact is that that is a wild and outlandish speculation. There's, as far as I'm aware, no study that suggests that all the polar ice caps are going to melt, even with 4 degrees Celsius of climate change, by the end of the century. Okay, those tipping points are unpredictable, and so you have to just kind of make do with what you can predict. Okay, the second question, how much of the climate change is human-caused? This is the question of so-called sensitivity. It's controversial. As I said earlier, it's fair to say at least 50%, maybe closer to 90%, right? This makes a rather large difference. As climatologist and former chair of the School of Earth and Atmospheric Sciences at the Georgia Institute of Technology, Judith Curry, wrote in the Wall Street Journal, the implications of the lower values of climate sensitivity in our paper, as well as in similar other recent studies, is that human-caused warming near the end of the 21st century should be less than 2 degrees Celsius danger level for all but the IPCC's most extreme emissions scenario. Okay, so this begs a third question, which is when should we start worrying about climate change? Because obviously, if there's slight climate change, or if it goes down a little bit, or if it goes up a lot, or then it goes down again, that's been happening for all of human history, right? Climate change, it has never, the climate that it is today, it was not 100 years ago, it was not 500 years ago, it was not 1,000 years ago, climate does change. So the question is, when does this become dangerous? How dangerous and how much does it cost? Okay, so this is the big question. According to every member of the political left, including every Democrat that you saw on stage last night, we are now in the midst of an existential crisis in which all human life on Earth is endangered. I've yet to see any serious scientific evidence that this is the case. Right, there's been talk about rising water levels over the course of the century. True. And it's also true that human migration has been happening over the course of all of human history. So when we suggest that people are sort of just going to stay there for the next 100 years and never move, that does not seem to be particularly accurate. And then there's talk about ocean acidification. Listen, real danger, right? These are real dangers. They're serious dangers, and we should take them seriously. Now, the IPCC released a report recently suggesting the world had to come together to stop climate change from hitting 2 degrees Celsius, right? This was their standard, and you hear the media repeat this all the time. We have to stop this thing before it hits 2 degrees Celsius. Okay, now that's rather absurd, and so are their solutions. The IPCC report found that, quote, limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius would require rapid and far-reaching transitions in land, energy, industry, buildings, transport, and cities. What kind of transitions did the IPCC suggest to prevent 1.5 degrees Celsius of climate change? Transitions like a $27,000 tax on each ton of carbon by 2100. That's equivalent to roughly $250 tax per gallon of gasoline. Per gallon. Okay, that's not happening. So, for a more realistic estimate, I look to William Nordhaus of Yale. And you know who else looks there? Many members of the left. See, here's the dirty little secret. When you talk to people on the left behind closed doors about climate change, they will acknowledge everything that I'm about to say to you. All of it. It's just when they come out in public that very often that they will say, well, no, if we just shut down the entire economy, then everything will be all better. But most of the people on the left recognize a lot of this stuff is now baked in. Most of the people on the left recognize that the pie in the sky proposals that are being made by Democrats for global carbon taxes are not going to happen. And so many of them have started focusing much more realistically on things like mitigation and adaptation. I mean, those would be the things that you worry about. Okay, so let's talk about William Nordhaus. He just won the Nobel Prize in Economics last year. He's the father of the so-called DICE model, which is one of the models used by the Obama administration in determining regulatory strategy on global warming. Nordhaus argues that the optimal trajectory for climate would not be to prevent 1.5 degrees Celsius of climate change, or 2 degrees, or 2.5 degrees, or 3 degrees. It would be to stop the climate from warming more than 3.5 degrees Celsius in global temperature by 2100. Nordhaus argues, quote, the international target for climate change with a limit of 2 degrees Celsius appears to be infeasible. A target of 2.5 degrees Celsius is technically feasible, but it would require extreme and virtually universal global policy measures in the near future. If we worked to keep the climate from changing more than 2.5 degrees Celsius, Nordhaus says, we would avert over the course of the next century $91 trillion in damage. It would only cost humanity $134 trillion to do so. So what Nordhaus does, because he's an economist, is he says, okay, so where is the tipping point? Where is it that we'd be spending more than we would lose? Which is the question at order, right? I mean, that's the question that we want to know. Okay, that's very different from the estimate suggested by AOC in the Green New Deal, who suggests retrofitting every single building in the United States, killing all the cows, not flying anymore. Right, so what should we do about climate change, right? This brings us to the final question. What should we do about climate change? Well, we have a few options. The first is mitigation, typically. The second is adaptation. Adaptation is both better proven and more likely to work over time. Here is why. So mitigation, which is preventing more carbon from being spewed into the air by all of the industrial activities that have made Western civilization prosperous and continue to make poor people all around the world prosperous. I'm sorry that carbon-based fuels are efficient. They just are. I didn't make it that way. That's just the way things are. And if you're asking a family in the middle of sub-Saharan Africa not to use carbon-based emissions because you are worried about climate change in 100 years, while they are worried about literally their children dying from heat exhaustion, or they are worried about their children dying because they cannot use fossil fuels to power light bulbs, right? Because there have to be energy plants, right? That is first worldism at its best. Right? It is a sad fact of human life that environmentalism is a first world concern. It is, because when you're trying to get by and make sure your kids don't die, this is last on your list of things that you care about. So if you really believe that you're going to cram down a carbon-free world on people who are literally, in many cases, burning animal dung for fuel, you got another thing coming. Okay, it also happens to be a pipe dream. When people say, oh, the Paris Accords, the wonderful Paris Climate Accords. We'll get to that in a second. But suffice it to say, China and India both signed on to the Paris Climate Accords. They are the world's leading carbon emitters. They're not going to lower their emissions anytime soon. Again, that is because if you are a developing country, you would like to become a developed country. And the way that you do that typically is by using carbon-based fuels. And as I say, the Paris Accords are a dud anyway. Dr. Bjorn Lomborg, climatologist, he found in his research that the Paris Accords would have done nothing about global temperature. He said, if we measure the impact of every nation fulfilling every promise by 2030, the total temperature reduction would be 0.048 degrees Celsius by 2100. Even if we assume these promises would be extended for another 70 years, there's still little impact. If every nation fulfills every promise by 2030 and continues to fulfill those promises until the end of the century, and there is no CO2 leakage to non-committed nations, the entirety of the Paris promises will reduce temperature rises by 0.17 degrees Celsius by 2100. In other words, most of the stuff is now baked into the cake. Right? The carbon that's in the air is going to stay in the air. By the way, it is worth noting that for all the criticism America has taken, our emissions have been falling steadily since 2000, at least 7.5% according to the EPA. In 2017, the U.S. had the largest reductions in carbon dioxide emissions of any country on planet Earth. So if we actually want to worry about climate change, which we should, then what we should be worried about is adaptation, right? We should be worried about geoengineering. There are experiments currently taking place about how to manipulate the climate, for example. There's been talk, you've seen it actually applied in some cities, about painting the roads white because it reflects light back into the air as opposed to absorbing it in the earth, and then you have the earth warming at a faster rate. They're developing machines in Britain that actually suck the carbon out of the air and then recompress it for further use if you want. And adaptation is even a better solution, because it turns out humans are great at adaptation, which is why there are 7 billion of us on the planet. And one of the great ways that you adapt is through capitalism, because one of the reasons that you are going to have a better world by 2100 than you have today, despite climate change, is that the economy is going to continue to grow by virtually every estimate. Warren Cass of the Manhattan Institute points out, regarding Nordhaus's model, by 2100, regardless of climate change, the entire world, is more than 6 times wealthier than in 2015. Right? Because we keep getting better at doing stuff. Human beings get better at doing stuff. So should we build more seawalls? Absolutely. Should we take mitigating measures? Of course. And does that involve infrastructure building? Sure. But if we are talking about completely destroying the entire carbon-based economy in favor of unproven technologies that do not compete on a per capita level, people don't know what they're talking about. This is particularly true with regards to some pie-in-the-sky folks on the left. Now, you want to know how somebody is pro-science and somebody's anti-science? Ask them a quick question on global warming. Should we get rid of natural gas and nuclear power? If their answer is yes, they are not serious about climate change. The entire American reduction in climate emissions is due to the substitution of natural gas for oil. The entirety. Okay? And nuclear energy is a very good solution, at least in certain sectors of human life, to reducing climate change, and yet Elizabeth Warren wants to ban both natural gas and nuclear energy, which means she is not serious. She is not serious. Okay, so, bottom line, science does matter. And we should all be able to at least look at the science in an honest and upright way. We should be constantly examining science, not limiting its findings or defunding the more controversial studies. Everyone, right, left, and center, should understand that science has brought about revolutionary changes in our lives. But that begins with the simple truth. Science collapses without reason. And politically correct SJWs taking over the scientific infrastructure will kill science. Thanks so much. Alrighty, so now for the fun part. We're gonna do some Q&A, and we always have a rule. The rule is that if you disagree, you raise your hand and you go to the front of the line, as always.
And with that, we will now be entering the Q&A portion of tonight, as Mr. Shapiro just said. We do ask that you exit to the rear of the house, and when you do so, please turn to the right. You will then see one of my colleagues there down the hall. We ask that you line up uniformly in a nice, neat line, and they will direct you through this door right behind me. And when you are passed through, we ask that you stand on this pink X. And with that, we will begin the Q&A.
I'm gonna wanna add one further stipulation, which is I'm going to restrict follow-up questions just because I wanna make sure that we get through as many as possible. I don't want each answer to get too long.
Right, one question.
You notice I talk a lot.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Nuance Bro. Good to see you again, Ben. So my question's gonna take a little bit of framing, as any good question does. Oh, I'll stand here, cool. So I hope you'll bear with that. And I'm gonna make some assumptions in the framing of this question, so if at any point you disagree with the assumptions, feel free to interrupt at any time. So I think we can all agree that just because something is legal doesn't necessarily mean it's moral. So for example, slavery was once legal, later illegal, but it was always immoral. Similarly, for something like a state-sanctioned genocide, the Holocaust, for example, where the Nazis were permitted to kill masses of people, it was always immoral. We could also fairly say, I think, that those who are targeted by genocide, as well as those in the larger society, would be justified in taking lethal action against those who are carrying out the genocide. I think that's just fair to say. Also, if people chose to bomb the centralized killing centers of these types of genocides, like the gas chambers at Auschwitz, we would say that that is justified. Also, it would be silly to ask people who are being genocided or people in that society at large to simply wait and not take vigilante action and to simply vote for a different government that would subsequently institute a different policy.
Okay, this is all fine. I'm with you.
Sure,
I'm almost there.
I promise I'm almost there. There is a question at the end of this. Yeah, hold on. Yeah, yeah. Just hold on. So I think it would be silly to ask them to do that when, potentially millions of people annually are dying on an ongoing basis, innocent people. It would be silly to ask them to do all that. So given all that, and you didn't interrupt, so I assume you agree with those moral assumptions.
Sure.
In there.
Yes.
You have said that Planned Parenthood is a genocidal organization and that abortion is murder. So my question is, do you support people who bomb abortion clinics? Do you feel like they are morally justified? And if not, why not? And do you take back things that you have said, like Planned Parenthood being a genocidal organization?
Okay, so number one, I don't take back a word I've ever said about Planned Parenthood. Number two, the only way that force becomes justified is when the system is unchangeable, meaning that my understanding of violence in a democracy, particularly internally in a democracy, is that when all other options are exhausted, then violence is justified. All other options have not been exhausted with regard to regulation of abortion. Beyond that, there's also the question of, as I would suggest, mens rea with regard to many of the people who work at Planned Parenthood. So many of them don't actually understand what they're doing. I think that if many people understood what they were doing, then that would be a much uglier thing. But with that said, again, if you're talking about broad scale changes in a society and how you accomplish that, there's also a pragmatic, so there's a moral issue and a pragmatic issue. One is that in a democracy, killing abortion doctors, for example, would be immoral so long as there are other options to stop the abortion doctor on the table that would be more effective. In my view, as a long-term matter, that is certainly going to be true of legal changes over time. Then there is the pragmatic issue, which is that if you started murdering abortion doctors, that wouldn't not only stop abortion, it would grant an entirely new life to the abortion movement. No, that was a really long question. Sorry.
No pressure being the first. Thank you for coming, first off. It's an honor and privilege having you here. So my question is, since I missed your Beto impersonation. It's revolving around gun control. So what I was wondering is, since most of your defenses I found on YouTube videos revolve around, I guess, defense against a tyrannical government or a government going tyrannical, how do you consistently define an upper bound on what is allowed? So for instance, we draw the line at, I can't go and buy a fully automatic firearm, for instance. How do you draw a consistent line that can't therefore be applied to, let's say, assault-style weapons?
Right, so I mean, I think that this is the question of politics. I'm not sure that there is such a thing as a thoroughly consistent line in all policy. I think that once the philosophy meets when the philosophical rubber meets the policy road, then there's a little bit of vagueness there, for sure. And I think that people can certainly disagree as to the use and necessity of banning, for example, fully automatic firearms. I think that once you get to a full ban on weaponry, now you have violated core principles of self-defense that were never delegated to the federal government. Right? And it's the same thing that I've said with regard to freedom of religion. Right? If the left has pushed certain restrictions on freedom of religion in public spaces, I think that's wrong. But as you'll note with the Beto kind of lead-in, I famously suggested that if Beto O'Rourke, who suggested in a Democratic debate that he would remove nonprofit status for every religious organization in America, because he's a nutcase, and you guys are crazy for having come close to electing him senator. And I'm very glad that he has now been relegated back to skateboarding and eating dirt in New Mexico. What I suggested is when no other alternative is available, then resistance becomes necessary. This was the view of the founders as well. So if Beto O'Rourke were to suggest, if the Democratic Party, let's say, not just Beto, if the Democratic Party were to mandate that I close down my synagogue, that I not be allowed to worship in my home, that not only I not be allowed to worship in my home, I couldn't teach my kid what I want, can't send my kid to a private school that teaches my morality, can't take my kid out of that private school when the government mandates it and shuts it down, I can't homeschool my kid because then they will accuse me of being a truant parent, and then they come to take my kid, that's when I think resistance is necessary and justified. I think the founders would agree.
Hello. I'm going to have a little bit of trouble articulating my question, so I hope that's okay. I hope you'll forgive me. This is just a little bit maybe off base. It's more of a religious question, if that's okay, and if not, then I'll be on my way. But so I understand that you're Jewish, and I wanted to ask you if you ever have any struggles with, like, your religious upbringing or, like, Jewish doctrine or what you've been taught or anything, and if so, how do you reconcile those? Because do they all fully correspond with your political ideas? Because at Baylor, for instance, a lot of people are just taught a lot of things, and I understand that, like, they'll have trouble with it, but because it's, you know, Christian or because they were taught it their whole life, they'll just accept it, and that's something that's really hard for me to grasp. So I was wondering, do you ever have any religious beliefs that, or things that you've been taught that, and my foot is shaking, it's not because I'm scared.
No, it's totally fine.
I think I broke my toe, but do you get what I'm saying?
What he's saying? Yeah, I do. I mean, I think that it is a misnomer to suggest that most religious people, I'd say nearly every religious person I know, doesn't struggle with their faith, doesn't struggle for the consonance between what they believe is reasonable and their own faith. You know, the word Israel in Hebrew is Yisrael. It literally means struggle with God. Right, so I think that the idea that you struggle with your faith, I mean, Abraham explicitly challenges God's justice in the book of Genesis, right? He says to God, how can you wipe out a whole city if there are 50 righteous men? He bargains with God. You see Moses bargaining with God at multiple points. So the idea that religious people sort of just take everything for granted and just take the morality as it's given, I don't think that that is exactly correct. And I've always, when it comes to government policy, separated out government policy from religious principle in the sense that I think that you have to have a secular rationale for any government policy that you undertake. The reason I say that is because there are a lot of people who simply don't abide by the Bible. So me citing the Bible would have no impact on their opinion. It's very silly. It would be like me citing, you know, origin of the species in church. Like, it just doesn't have any actual authority. It doesn't mean anything. So as far as, you know, people taking what they are given on faith, I think everybody should think through all of their ideas all of the time. Now, unborn human beings, for example. So. Again, I think that we should be able to articulate as religious people secular rationales for the public policy positions that we hold. And I think that we should be able to explain morality to our children in a reasonable way. So I think that there need to be religious bases to that. I do think there are core assumptions to religion that do not exist in a purely scientific materialist universe, including, like I say, the infinite value of every human being is not something backed by evolutionary Darwinism. Thank you.
Got it? Hey, thank you for this opportunity, Mr. Shapiro. I have a quick statement and then a question. As the left abandons science and fact, they become ableist. When I say ableist, most people will think I'm an SJW, but what I mean is that they become very intolerant of different ways of thinking. For example, many intelligent people are on the autism spectrum, but they struggle through the social landmine field that is political correctness. Do you have any advice for this group of people on how they may navigate the left's maze in pursuing their degree?
And it's a very specific and somewhat odd question. I'm not an expert on autism, so I don't really have tons of advice on how autistic people should handle the world around them. I wouldn't want to step into an area I really don't know. I can give you general advice on how to navigate the wilds of political correctness as a non-autistic person, which I do know, right? And my advice there is that is two things. One, just because someone declares something politically incorrect does not mean it doesn't need to be said. Sometimes it very much needs to be said. Second, just because you're being politically incorrect does not mean that you are saying one of those things. Okay, people tend to confuse these two things. Right? People tend to say, okay, well, I'm being an ass right now. I'm being politically correct because I'm being an ass. No, you're just being an ass. Right? Being politically correct is you're saying something that needs to be said regardless of the political sensitivities of people who are opposing you. Right? That is a very different thing from I'm just going to be a jerk and then call myself politically incorrect. I think it's a distinction we should all keep in mind. As far as the autism question, I'll reserve that question for somebody who actually knows something about autism, which I don't.
Hello. I would like to ask you, how come that European and Eastern European communists are very patriotic, do not believe all this rubbish you were talking about? And how come that it is, only a thing of Western people, Western leftists, that they think all this set of atrocities? And could you also elaborate how come that this set of atrocities, you know, happened? Isn't it that something deeper about it? What's the cause? Because you were talking only about
so
examples.
I apologize because I'm not fully understanding the question. You're trying to make a distinction between...
No. Yes. The question is clear. How come...
No, I mean, I literally don't... There's an echo in the room. I'm having a hard time understanding what...
Okay. So, how come...
Yes.
...that European, Eastern European communists are patriotic and do not believe this rubbish?
Uh-huh.
But Western liberals... do believe this. How come that those leftists who are supposed to be leftists, right, communists, are more patriotic and do not believe all these kind of things?
Okay, so why are European communists more patriotic? I mean, my simple answer would be is I actually don't think they understand International Workers of the World Unite very well. But again, I'll have to plead ignorance as to the specifics of Western European communism because I'm not supremely familiar with the distinctions between Western European communists and, for example, Western liberals. So if you want to send me an email with links to specific parties demonstrating their communism and commitment to science, then I'd be willing to take a look. But otherwise, I don't really have a frame of reference.
Hi, Ben. I had a question regarding the typical conservative approach to the topic of Islam. Mm-hmm. If you only watch conservative media, you would get the impression that Islam is only violent. And when we compare this...
Oh, hold up.
When you compare this to statistics, you see that Muslims are actually overwhelmingly politically moderate, and they're more conservative than they tend to be Republican. They overwhelmingly go liberal, despite the fact that a majority of them are not liberal.
Before you go on, I'll let you go on, I promise. Are you speaking specifically about Western Muslims, or are you speaking about global
Western Muslims?
Okay, just wanted to clarify, because if you're saying politically moderate, then obviously that should really only apply to Western Muslims, not to Afghan Muslims or you know, Egyptian Muslims, or virtually every majority Muslim governed place on Earth, which tends to not be moderate. There is yet to be a politically moderate majority Muslim Sharia law governed country. It doesn't exist. But if you're talking about Western Muslims, then yes, I think that that's true in large part. Okay.
Apologies, I should have made that clarification. My question is the typical way that conservatives have approached this topic potentially alienating some really, really strong allies for our cause, because whenever a Muslim turns into conservative media, they get acid thrown in their face?
So I think it's a bit of an exaggeration, but I will say that when I speak about Islam, and it's been bewildering to me when people suggest that I've attacked Islam itself, what I've suggested is that I tend to judge the adherence of religion more than the religion. Meaning, I'm not an expert on Islam. I don't know much about Islam. I've read the Quran, but that doesn't make me an expert any more than it makes Sam Harris a Bible expert having read the Bible, right? The fact is that there are lots of people, billions, a billion people who know Islam better than I do on planet Earth. I tend to look at the beliefs politically and the moral adherence of people to Islam. So that's why I asked you the distinction between Western Muslims and, for example, Muslims in other places in the world, because there is a rather large distinction. In fact, there's even large distinctions in the West, right? If you look at the polls of, for example, French Muslims and British Muslims versus U.S. Muslims, U.S. Muslims are much more moderate politically than British Muslims or French Muslims on topics like free speech, for example. Now, with that said, do I think that it is, I think that this is broken down into an unfortunate binary, and that is people who have decided to repeat the sort of slogan, Islam is peace, which is a meaningless slogan as far as I'm concerned. It's like saying Christianity is peace or Judaism is peace. I care about, in a political context, how people act, not what the religion purports to be, right? And then people who say Islam is violence. Well, Islam is not necessarily violence, but its adherents in many countries are quite violent. Is it a mistake to cast all Muslims with the same net? Yeah, 100%, which is why, for example, when Donald Trump suggested a full-on Muslim ban in the United States originally, right, he then didn't do it. So this is where the left gets it wrong, right? He didn't do it. Originally, he said during his campaign, we should ban all Muslims from entering the U.S. I thought that was silly. I thought it was counterproductive. And then he came forward with a travel ban, which applied to some 5 countries, leaving another 50 majority Muslim countries open to people visiting, for example. That, I thought, was perfectly plausible. But to paint with broad strokes always tends to be a little bit dangerous. In politics, people tend to do it. I've done it myself. But yeah, I mean, I think obviously people should be careful in how. Now, does that mean that we should downplay the existence of extremism when it does exist? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So if you are making excuses for terrorism in any way, I think we're all on the same page. This makes you an extremist, right? If you are making excuses for the mistreatment of women, I think this makes you an extremist. If you are a believer, in my view, in the destruction of the state of Israel, this makes you an extremist, right? So these are areas where the percentage of the Muslim population versus percentage of the Christian population, there may be a differential there. But to blame Islam itself, I'm always hesitant to blame a religion itself because, listen, I believe in a holy book that has some pretty violent sections, and I'm always wary of delving into other people's texts without being a proper interpreter.
So earlier you said that those who think about a societal benefit of access to abortion have a valid point. So apparently I have a valid point. Specifically, the Donahue-Levitt hypothesis asks that children who are born into communities that have high crime rates turn to crime more often than not. So what kind of societal benefit would you say would make access to abortion reasonable?
There is no societal benefit that makes access to abortion reasonable because the killings of human beings and human life is inherently unreasonable. If you're asking me for, like, you're asking me for a utilitarian perspective on evil behavior, and I'm not a utilitarian when it comes to this sort of stuff. I mean, you could ask exactly the same question about what level of societal benefit would have to be derived from slavery in order to make slavery decent. The answer is no level of societal benefit from slavery makes slavery decent. If you're a believer, as I am, that the killing of unborn human beings is inherently a moral evil, then of course no level of societal benefit, economic or otherwise, would justify the killing of unborn human beings.
Hello, Mr. Shapiro. Big fan. Got my Tumblr in my dorm right now. Listen to the podcast on the daily. So happy you're here. My question is, a lot of conservatives, we have so much things to think about that we often forget some other issues related to the nature of the sanctity of life, such as embryonic stem cell research, which unfortunately the Trump administration still hasn't defunded, IVF clinics storing lots of human embryos, and physician-assisted suicide. As a conservative leader, what actions could you and we do to help raise awareness of these issues?
Well, I mean, I think they're all certainly worth discussion. The Bush administration did end federal funding of research in certain lines of embryonic stem cell research. If you want to read a beautiful column on this, read a column by the late Charles Krauthammer, who obviously suffered from paralysis and talked in amazing terms about why he supported the Bush administration ban on the use of embryonic stem cell research. He talked about the balance of life and all that. It really is an amazing, amazing column because he was an amazing human being. I had the opportunity to meet him a couple of times. And the world is lesser for his lack of presence. As far as things like physician-assisted suicide, I mean, obviously those are, you know, that's an issue that I think deserves serious scrutiny. I think that making doctors into agents of death is an inherently very, very dangerous business. And creating a death-centered industry where doctors are being paid to kill people is incredibly dangerous as well. Now, I do think that there is a difference between a physician-assisted suicide and, for example, withdrawal of care. So you don't wish to prolong your life artificially, and you just decide that you're not going to get a treatment, or you're not going to take a drug, or you want to be withdrawn from life support. I don't see that as a moral issue. I do see it as a moral issue for a doctor to actively cause your death, because now you have asked a doctor to violate the very basics of the Hippocratic Oath.
The next question will be our final one for the night.
Hi, Ben. Thank you for coming this way. I'm from San Antonio. Had a question. You preface everything with religion and science, and as a man of faith, you said you accept the principles of macroevolution, and I wanted to know, as a man of faith, how do you reconcile Darwinian evolution with a belief in Genesis? And as one who literally interprets the book of Genesis myself, where do you draw the line between an allegorical approach in the literal historical account of Genesis? Where do you draw that line? If it's all not literal, how do you decide what's allegorical versus what's literal in reconciling that with Darwinian evolution in your
Genesis? Okay, so the way that I draw an allegorical approach to particularly the first couple of chapters of Genesis is because the first couple chapters of Genesis, in my opinion, are obviously written with an eye toward allegory. So for example, it says at the beginning of the book of Genesis, right, Yom Echad, right? This is the day one, right? And then it'll say that there was day two. Well, so first of all, God creates light before he creates the sun, right? Second of all, how do you measure the length of a day when there is no sun and no earth? So the way that we measure an earth day is by the rotation of the earth versus the sun, right? But how do you measure a 24-hour period in a time when hours don't exist yet and there is no basis for the length of the day? There have been some good sort of writings on how you square the science with the verbiage of Genesis 1, Genesis 2. It's also true that there are two Genesis accounts, right? There's the Genesis account that talks about the creation of various things on various days and then talks about the creation of man on day 6. And then the Bible goes back and then it talks specifically about the creation of Adam and Eve on day 6. So why does it bother to tell the story twice if there's no allegory to it and there's no deeper meaning to it than just it's a story about a man and a woman eating an apple? So I think that there's certainly room for an allegorical approach. Also, I tend to believe in the sort of Maimonidean approach and the Thomas Aquinas approach to this, frankly, which is that if there is a lack of convergence between faith and reason, then you're getting one or the other wrong. Right? Because if God created both, if God created science and he created faith, there really should not be a conflict between them. And if you can't misinterpret the science, right, if the science is clear enough, then you have to start looking at whether you've misinterpreted a text. So that is how, on a moral level, I would square that stuff. As far as where I think the Bible starts getting very literal, I think the Bible starts getting literal. And this is, there's large-scale arguments about this in the Talmud, but to avoid a Talmudic lecture in front of 2,200 people who have no idea what I'm talking about, there are some fairly good opinions that suggest that the Bible starts to get literal around the time of Abraham. That before that, it's allegorical to a certain extent. But you know, again, I can see arguments on the other side. I understand why biblical literalists would like to take the Bible literally. I just tend to hold again with the Maimonidean approach that if science conflicts with the Bible, then you're getting one or the other of them wrong. And listen, if you prove the science wrong to me, then I'll take that too. That's okay. But so far, the science seems to be fairly good on the age of the earth, for example. And so, as I say, it seems like there's ample room in the Bible for interpretation of particular time periods in the day, as opposed to a 24-hour day.